Hi, it's Rob Moore here, and welcome to the Disruptive Entrepreneur video and audio podcast. And very privileged today to have in pretty much the whole of the UK and possibly the world a legend in the house, a six-time snooker world champion, MBE, OBE, and something I'm really interested in for entrepreneurs who are listening in is how you've managed to make so many different careers. Because I guess you're normally talking about snooker, but you're into music. I remember watching you play pool and you transitioned from snooker to pool. And I used to play a lot of pool, and I guess people who don't know the difference assume it's the same, and it's nothing like snooker and pool. So straight in with the first question, how have you managed to build so many different careers?
Well, exactly. I wouldn't necessarily say careers. I would say gone in different directions, because I'm not absolutely sure that I'm exactly the same animal as you, in as much as I fell in love with a sport and a game, and then that took me on a journey. Mm. I never really had a preconceived idea about where I wanted to go. Mm-hmm. All I did was fall in love with trying to get a ball in a hole with a stick.
Right.
So, to some degree, I don't think I've ever been a master of my own destiny, mm-hmm. other than the fact that obviously I practiced very hard and became very good at what I did. Mm. But I know lots of other people who practiced equally as hard,
really,
who didn't have whatever it takes to make it to the top of the snooker world, who would say, well, in that respect, it's just that there's an element of luck attached to if somebody becomes well known.
Sure.
But as a result of becoming successful in my chosen sport or game and then becoming well known, doors then open that otherwise wouldn't be open to you. Yeah. So, yes, I get involved in doing the TV work. That's a natural progression from being an expert in the game to becoming an analyst and doing some commentary and doing the DJing thing, which is a recent bizarre thing that's happened in my life, has no relevance to anything
whatsoever.
You're just
trying to break the stereotype of you, Steve, that's been built.
It just happened that the fact that I quite like collecting records as a hobby, and all of a sudden it went and do a radio show, which is on a small community radio station, and the next minute doing a few live promotions, got a bit of advertising, and then Glastonbury phones up and I'm now DJing at Glastonbury.
Right.
So, but from getting back to your original point of how do you manage to do that, wasn't a conscious effort.
So I'm a serial interrupter here.
Yes,
we'll get back to the point. One thing I picked up on is you said you just followed your passions, it seems. So you love music, you love snooker, I guess you must have loved pool, you must love doing TV. So are you saying you've just followed your passions and things have worked out?
I think so, yeah. I think I've sort of considered myself very lucky that my hobby became my profession. Mm-hmm. I don't think that's necessarily always the case. I would say to anybody that was a young kid at school, you know, like you think you've got to do this and that, in as much as, you know, you've got to go to uni, you've got to do this, you've got to do that. I would say if you've got a strong interest in something, to pursue that, because I think if you actually enjoy your job, you've got more chance of it becoming a successful job and also something that's rewarding.
Sure.
Not everybody's got a hobby or a passion that could become a job.
Yeah.
Spec.
But we were just talking before about snooker and it not really being the biggest money sport, weren't we?
No, that's right. And obviously, you know, your favourite game in the world was kabaddi, or
which I don't even know what it is.
Marvelous Indian game.
Right.
Fantastic. Yeah. The world of kabaddi's not hit the television screens yet. But let's say for instance you're a squash player, a badminton player.
Yeah.
For thinking of two great games that probably aren't the highest profile, the well-known people in the, and they, perhaps the prize money's not marvelous. I don't know. Snooker's done very well considering it's a pastime for most.
Right.
And we were very fortunate that the game was picked up by BBC initially. Yeah. To show off colour television, and then before we knew it, we were household names.
Yeah.
So from that perspective, I consider myself very fortunate to be in the right place at the right time.
Right.
And on another given parallel universe, I could have been a badminton player doing very well, but not as well as the snooker players.
Right.
But the snooker game is not as popular as golf or tennis worldwide, and the strange thing about that is the viewing figures are pretty decent for snooker, and probably more so if you look, I'm not absolutely sure. You look at the viewing figures for golf in the UK compared to the viewing figures for snooker, I think probably snooker does very well.
Yeah.
But the prize monies are different.
Do you think maybe there's a lot of people who watch snooker but don't play it, but golf, a lot of people play it as well? I mean, it's huge in America. There's so many people play golf, don't they, in America?
Yeah, they do. And it's obviously where sponsors want to be seen to be entertaining their customers and hospitality. Right. And whilst snooker's good fun, and the World Championship, great event, shown on the television, we've always felt that perhaps it was a second-class game compared to golf and tennis for the some of the sponsorship.
Yeah.
But we still have great sponsors, and we respect those sponsors. Sure. But getting into the blue-chip companies has been quite tough for snooker.
Yeah.
Fortunately, we've got quite a good entrepreneur now at the helm, Barry Hearn, my best friend and manager, very nice.
Yeah.
And he's done wonders to turn it around, but there's still other levels to get to.
Yeah. Okay, so I want to pick up on Barry, a manager and friend, in a moment. What I really like doing for myself, I just, one of my passions is to study, observe, and get to know and become friends with successful people and try and get in their head and work out some common threads I can maybe learn that maybe helps me develop better as a property investor, entrepreneur, interviewer, etc. And then also, I've got a community like you, you know, not on a global scale. Well, actually on a global scale, but some countries, only a few. So you said, in snooker, you practiced a lot, but you knew other people who practiced a lot. But is there anything Steve Davis could say that did make him become successful?
I think I had a very good work ethic. I didn't really ever sit back for very much time, even after successful events, before I was back on the practice table working on my game. So I don't remember ever thinking I've cracked it, great.
And did you see other snooker players who were a bit like that?
I can't say, because I didn't see them in the period of time after an event had happened. But obviously, that not everybody would have been so perhaps blinkered and one-dimensional in one respect as far as how you went about your job.
Yeah.
So I think I probably had a good outlook that I kept my feet on the ground.
Yeah.
I think lucky to have parents who were that way as well, that's helpful. But when it comes to a sport, it's not an equal playing field in one respect. I mean, probably the same in business. You've got your brain, okay? In sport, you've got to have the ability, the knack, okay?
Yeah.
So whilst you can go, I did this differently. I studied the technique and I improved technique. I moved it on another level, and I perhaps went to another level of preparing match play wise.
Yeah.
You've still got to have that X factor that is unquantifiable and possibly not something you can learn.
Yeah.
It's got to be in your body, in your makeup. So I hesitate to say that I did anything differently from anybody else, because it may just be I was better than them because that was how it was.
Yeah, well, I suppose if every percent of success was quantifiable, we could all just have a blueprint for it. So there's a...
Yeah.
But then we still want to strive to learn, don't we, to be the best?
I think my pursuit of perfection on the practice table with my technique was something that always held me in good stead.
Yeah.
So I never stopped trying to learn.
Yeah.
And whilst there was a danger that you can tinker with something just for that sake of tinkering, I was always looking to try and upgrade my technique, therefore trying to upgrade my standard.
Yeah.
I don't know how many of the other players were actually physically self-critical to that degree. So I think you should always question yourself, even if you're being successful, as to is there another level you could achieve if you improve something? So going back in sporting history, Nick Faldo, apparently at some stage in his career decided to dismantle his technique.
Change his swing.
Rechange it. Well, and you would go, well, that's madness. He's successful anyway. Why on earth would you want to do that? Mm. Well, he felt that was the only way he could get to the next level.
Yeah.
So whilst I probably didn't necessarily go to that level.
Yeah, you didn't go left-handed or anything like that.
I think I probably was always looking to upgrade. So, and I would say that's probably the only area. I mean, that's the only area, and nothing else really could spring to mind.
Okay. Most successful entrepreneurs I've ever met, it's a similar thing in a different world, which is always looking to grow, always looking to, constant, never-ending improvement. There's a saying, probably quite a cliched one, which is it's not practice that makes perfect, but perfect practice that makes perfect. So were you the, you know, trying to beat balls and hit as many balls as possible, or did you discover some little techniques which made your practice more perfect, if you see what I mean? Because you can pot thousands of balls a day, or you can...
Yeah. I think you really are... I certainly felt as if I was sort of finding my own way in that area. Mm-hmm. I didn't have a mentor that had previously gone down that road, so like an Ivan Lendl, who would be
Andy Murray's career. Yeah.
I didn't
today
have
today he's world number one.
Yes,
what a massive, amazing achievement.
Yeah, I didn't have a sports psychologist because that was never the way back mid 70s, 80s, and I don't think I would have wanted one, but I had my father who was on my side, in my corner.
So you didn't have a mentor, but you kind of did.
I sort of had somebody who was in my corner who wasn't that knowledgeable about the game, not massively knowledgeable, but was enthusiastic enough to be my overseer. Yeah. He was continually watching me play and going, you've changed that, you need to get that back to there. So he was always looking at me. So he, even though he wasn't that great a snooker player, he could keep an eye on me.
Yeah.
So we together as a team tried to work out what was the best types of practice.
Yeah.
And whether I got it right or not is another matter, because
well,
I look back.
Six world championships.
Yeah, I know, yeah. Well, I look back at my sort of career, and I think if I'd have had my time to do it again, I may not have done so much practice, because I probably could have improved the quality instead of the quality. A percentage of time from a snooker perspective, you've got to play the game.
Yes.
A bit like a boxer's got to go in and spar. You can't just shadow box. Yeah. He needs to play the game. So a percentage of time, you'd have to effectively play against another player in a match situation, sparring. But if I had my time again, I would do it differently. I think I did make mistakes in as much as I didn't concentrate on things that now are very important.
Like what?
Then that would be the importance upon heavy scoring within the game. And that sounds stupid to say that, because you've got to pot the balls to get points to score. But the modern day players now are very one visit, one break, it's all over. And they become very good at positional play.
Yeah.
I don't think I probably studied positional play as much as I should have done.
Right.
I remain constantly on minor technical changes.
Yeah.
Perhaps if I had my time again, I would go down the road of trying to improve my positional routes around the table.
Right.
I don't exactly know how that's, but there is a way that I think the modern day successful people could probably teach the older people new tricks.
Yeah.
And I didn't really see that at the time, but now I look back, I think that perhaps you should be, to be cutting edge, you've got to try and be once, you've got to try and look at what is going to happen.
Yeah.
And what I should have seen, perhaps, was that there was going to be another level of player above me, and they would be better, not just at potting the balls, but also playing the positional side. And I should have tried to have upgraded that.
Yeah.
That's about it, really.
Yeah.
I think that's all I can sort of criticise myself for.
Mm. Okay. So did you ever play practice matches with any really good players?
Strangely enough, no. I kept away from them.
Was that an intentional decision?
Yeah, I didn't want... I
see the weapons.
No, I don't know if it was because I didn't want to expose, to get too friendly with them.
Yeah.
I didn't know if... I'm not sure whether it was because I felt that perhaps they'd be better in practice than I was.
Right.
I'd be a better match player.
Yeah.
But they're a better practice player. And if we played enough in practice, they might suss that out.
Right.
I don't know whether I was being quite defensive in that. So I used to play people I could beat.
Yes.
But you can always, like in same as golf, you can give somebody a handicap
and
have a relatively decent game.
Yeah.
So I did keep away from other top players.
That's interesting.
Yeah, and another thing, is that the right thing to do? Probably not, because the modern day players all play against each other and fight in the pit with each other in practice, and they become much more proficient and much more hardened. So I had it all my own way in the 80s.
Yeah.
But then when Stephen Hendry came along, who was a player who moved the game further up. Mm-hmm. I was quite fragile when that happened, and then from then on, I don't think I was the same player. So yeah. Perhaps if I had have played a lot more decent players, perhaps I'd have been more prepared for that.
Yeah. Okay. And you transitioned into, let me get this right, it's nine ball, isn't it?
Well, no.
I remember watching you do American ball.
Yes, I did. Well,
is that nine ball or is that eight ball?
Nine ball was the game.
Yeah.
The only reason why it would appear as if I made a career move in that respect is that Sky showed a lot of that on television, yeah. And they also showed a lot of repeats.
Yeah.
So it looked like I was playing more than I was.
Right.
Effectively, what happened was that Barry Hearn, who is one of the biggest independent broadcasters of producers of sporting footage in the UK,
yeah.
Was looking to expand his portfolio and saw that nine ball pool was a exciting game for yeah. America, created an event called the Moscone Cup, yeah. And you know, the rip off of the Ryder Cup,
yeah.
Named after the great Willie Moscone, the pool player,
yeah.
And needed a few British players.
Ah, interesting. So it wasn't it was encouraged by someone else.
So I was a mercenary.
Right. You were a hired gun.
I was a hired hand.
Yeah.
So me and Jimmy White started to play pool,
yeah.
Along with some of the European players to get a European team together.
Yeah.
We weren't good enough, really, but we learned our trade a bit.
Did you ever win a Moscone Cup?
We won the Moscone Cup.
I watched it.
One of my most favourite memories was beating the Americans.
Yeah.
After we'd been bashed up five times on the trot.
Yeah.
The Germans hated the American players.
Right.
The German lads were, and they all hated the Americans because they all felt they were too big-headed.
Yeah.
And Oliver Altman was our captain.
Yeah, yeah, I remember.
And he was like, he just hated them all. Right? And I, when I first arrived on the side, I thought, well, they're nice people. Yeah. I don't see what's the problem. But after year of us getting beaten and them shoving it down our throat, in the end, I learned to hate them as well.
Yeah.
So collectively hate them.
Yeah, yeah.
And when we beat them, I mean, we were crying our eyes out.
Yeah,
yeah, it was a fantastic moment.
I loved it.
It was a fantastic moment. Yeah, and I must admit, even though it was a foray into a game that wasn't my chosen game, still a ball and a stick.
Yeah.
But I got great value out of the Moscone Cup, for great fun. So talking about, you know, job satisfaction, wonderful.
Mm.
Yeah. And that, you know, to some degree, regardless of how much you get paid for things,
yeah.
Some things you can't really buy. And the excitement of the Moscone Cup always sits there.
Sure. I am Frank Bruno sat on the same seat a few months ago.
It's a bit of a dent.
Yes. they're quite cozy.
And, he's a big boy, isn't he?
He is. He's still a big boy and still in really good shape.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's become a good friend. And one thing he really stressed when I interviewed him was pretty much straight away he was getting good advice. He's got to plan a career after boxing. You know, you can get hit, you can lose your faculties.
Yeah.
Was there ever a strategic plan for you to have a... beyond snooker career?
I must admit, during the whole 80s, I thought I was invincible,
right.
And nothing was ever going to change.
Yeah.
I don't know that anybody could have foreseen that snooker would still be around on TV at the start of the 80s.
Yeah.
And even by the end of the 80s, I mean, I don't think necessarily anybody would have had the vision to know that it was guaranteed to be on television.
Do you think maybe your rivalry with Stephen Hendry was part of keeping it interesting?
Possibly, yeah, and I think all the rivalries sort of, you know, are, yeah, all those things are irrelevant. But from my own perspective, I don't really think I thought too far into the future. What I would say is that, judging myself as an animal, I would say that to be good at something, especially a sport, I don't think you are actually that. You don't have that much vision into the future or the
right.
past. I think it's probably the reason why you're good at your sport. Is because you don't look too far
right.
into the future and you don't look into the past.
So maybe that's why you need good people around you, like Barry.
Possibly, yes. Mm. I think, and of course, that then asks the question, you know, if you fall in with the wrong manager, the wrong agent, you're vulnerable. Because I do think that people in sport, that's their job, that's what they're good at.
Yeah.
They probably don't have that many other good skills, or there's every chance they have. I mean, occasionally you're going to get something.
Well, you just can't put your time everywhere, can you? So
no, yeah. But I think... so therefore, I think if you're lucky, if you fall on your feet and you bump into somebody who's a good egg, so to speak, in that department,
yeah,
you can have some sort of judgment yourself. You know you don't basically, it's your own fault if you don't see the signs.
Yeah,
but you know some people I think fall on their feet better than others. And but I certainly didn't have a plan. I don't think I've ever had a plan. It's worry. I mean, I look at you and think you've got a plan. I haven't got a plan. I don't know what a plan is. Basically, I'm just trying to work out what I'm doing on the planet.
Yeah.
Right. I don't know about you. I haven't got a clue what I'm doing on the planet.
Well, okay. I have.
Have you? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, I mean,
yeah.
I don't know. I don't know what we're doing here. Anyway, carry on.
Right, so, does Barry manage some of your affairs then? He's your agent, is he?
Yeah, and he's like an older brother, great mate, agent, manager, all rolled into one. And I've watched him grow from being owner of a few snooker clubs.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden liking matches.
Oh, should we just carry on? We've had a power cut. We'll carry on, Steve.
Okay.
Yeah.
Liking watching snooker matches to all of a sudden realising that he liked to promote things and then it growing into not just promoting and taking an interest in management of sporting people, but also branching out into managing sports and promoting other sports and ended up creating TV programmes and went with the flow, the same thing. Pool was a big one.
Yeah.
Poker was massive.
Yeah.
Darts has become even more massive now.
Yeah. And he's behind all of those, is he?
He's behind all of those, yeah. Wow. I mean, most of the poker you've seen on the television over the years.
He must be doing all right then.
Yeah, he's doing okay. Yeah. He's doing, and Matchroom Sports grown.
Yeah.
And I've seen him, you know, grow as a person and become, you know, I think, you know, marvellous to watch it happen.
Yeah.
As an entrepreneur, which is much more scope than a snooker player in a way.
Yeah.
But it's been great watching, the journey's been amazing because we started off just the two of us.
Yeah.
In my manager, me a player. He didn't have a clue if I was going to become any good or not, but
so what
I did.
Sorry again, serial interrupter.
No problem.
What does a snooker manager do for a snooker player?
Well, I mean, really the only reason you would need a manager in any sport is if you can generate off-table earnings.
And that's why he called you the Nugget, isn't it?
No, the Nugget came from the fact that when I toured around the country as an amateur, all my mates that used to follow me around would have a bet on me.
Right.
With the other guys' mates.
Right.
And I had such a good strike rate that I was there. I was basically money in the bank.
Right.
I was their golden nugget that was more or less buying money.
Right.
And so, like, if you're that much a favourite, that's more or less what it is.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I had many nicknames, but But Barry's sort of involvement was really initially good because he was quite a strong character, good presence. You know, whereas I was shy and retiring and everything. You know, I was just playing snooker.
Yeah.
He was shouting from the rooftops that I was going to be the best player in the world.
Right.
And that was good to have somebody on your side like that.
Did that help you believe in yourself more?
I think it probably did, that somebody else was sort of fighting my corner for me. Even though, you know, he couldn't help me pot the balls, it was good to have somebody on my side like that. So I had a pretty strong team. My father, technical, and my father.
Yeah.
And Barry, who was like this larger-than-life character, who was in my corner. And probably, psychologically, did a little bit of damage to the other players because in the end they believed it.
Yeah.
Or they just let it happen, perhaps.
Well, I mean, Muhammad Ali, look at how that affected people.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, talk a lot in business about having a great team. That's definitely something I'm picking up on.
Yeah, and I probably didn't know it at the time. And it wasn't a massive team. It's not like, you know, a dietitian or all that. But it was there was like that hardcore. Then a couple of people around us sort of like, a couple of friends who became sort of drivers and to be wrong to say gophers, but people just to help you out on the day so you got some company. Mm-hmm. And I think that we were the first people to do it like that. Mm-hmm. Then Stephen Hendry came along, still the most successful snooker player.
Yeah.
And his manager up in Scotland more or less replicated what Barry had sort of set up.
Right.
And had a strong team ethic as well.
Yeah.
And I think that made Stephen Hendry more invincible.
Yeah.
That it was strong, you know, not just the fact he was a great player, but he also had good management behind him. And that's how it was perceived by all the other players who didn't even have a manager, so to speak. But that's a situation where I don't know of a snooker player who's ever really been in a situation to sell themselves off the table.
Yeah.
It's better for somebody else to sell you as a commodity than it is for you to not only play the game, but then have to deal with sponsorships. And
so that he also did that deal with all your...
Yeah, and I think that would be a hard thing to do. You'd have to be quite a strange snooker player to be good in that department as well as being able to play the game.
Yeah.
Because they're different beasts, I think.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I mean, Cristiano Ronaldo credits a lot of his success to his agent, his family friend. In football, for example, you can make one bad, like Balotelli moves to Liverpool, really bad move for his career. One bad move. And I guess agents, because you talked about vision and maybe you not having it. Barry sounds like he must have it if he went from a few snooker tables to...
I think so, yeah. Or having the imagination, on-the-spot imagination, or being able to go with the flow and having the talent when the flow happens.
Yeah.
And I mean, I don't know what the difference is, whether people sit down and go and make a 10-year plan where they want to be, or whether when the moment comes, they're ready with all of these ideas in their head. But interestingly, Barry Hearn over the years has bumped into loads of different people from loads of different sports. And one person that he thinks is quite exceptional in not just being probably going to be the best in the world for a fair length of time, but also has a good head business-wise on his shoulders, is Anthony Joshua, the boxer.
Ah, yes.
So at some stage, that would probably be a very good interview subject for you.
Yeah, okay, well, if you're watching, I love Barry as well. If he's
great talking, yeah, I'm sure he would do.
I mean, he's. I just talking about him quickly. It look, from the outside, it looks like he's good. Got good people around him because it looks like he's picking his fights well, and he's doing this.
Yes, he
and
is.
He's
yeah.
not just doing this, or you know.
No, well, I mean, the world of boxing is a very strange world. It's obviously a lot of boxing fights are stepladder fights that you can't lose.
Yeah.
But obviously, the other side of it, if you go in too quickly, you can get damaged.
Yeah.
So it's always a case of making the right decisions for the boxers. But in the past, there's always a temptation. But when you get somebody who's excellent, no, really excellent, sometimes it's not going to make any difference because they're going to cut through the riffraff, so to speak, a lot quicker than others.
Yeah.
So everybody's predicting that, you know, he's going to be a unified world champion for many years, and he's so strong.
Yeah,
it's got to be done.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, yeah. But he's already on the way. So, yeah. And it's fascinating watching that happen. Whilst Barry Hearn doesn't manage him, he promotes his fights.
Yeah,
So, but managing is a very strange art. I mean, at one stage, Barry Hearn was managing lots of people.
Right.
But it's a bit like probably having employees.
Yeah,
that's got its own headaches.
Yeah, they say six, maybe eight at a max is the most you should manage.
Yeah,
before you're spread too thin.
But even so, you're dealing with human beings.
Yes,
who can let you down as well.
Yes,
not just you might be doing a good job, but the person themselves is not good enough as well. So from that perspective, over the years of management, he's shied away from more than in the end, he doesn't really manage anybody so much now.
What I've seen, my experience in business world is, entrepreneurs and managers are also different beasts. You know, a manager will care for an individual, look after their needs, be able to follow a system and a process, be there and available. An entrepreneur is like, let's go over here, let's beat the path down.
Yeah.
And often, generally speaking, of course, but often entrepreneurs make terrible managers, and great managers don't necessarily make good visionaries.
No, I can see that. I'd say perhaps Barry's been okay, actually. I'd say he's been very good in all departments. But I can understand how that could be the case. But I would say that he's probably found his ideal setup now.
Yeah.
But of course, he's now getting, you know, he's an old man now. He's got his heating out.
Yeah, he's
69 years old. Hopefully he is.
69. Yeah.
Can't believe it. But his son, Eddie Hearn, has now taken over the boxing.
Yeah.
And is doing a marvellous job. He's a chip off the block.
Yeah.
And Barry rates him very highly as doing a better job than he ever done in the boxing world. So, you know, that whilst you can try to learn to be good at something, when you look at the genetic makeup of people, the fact that Eddie Hearn is the same animal as his dad.
Could he have just learned it from his dad, though? You know, over like, how old is Eddie?
He's 30, probably 30 now.
So could he have learned it over 30 years?
Well, he could have done.
Yeah.
But, you know, are you breeding true? I mean, are we better than racehorses or not so good as racehorses for breeding true?
Yeah.
My two kids, one of them tried to be a good snooker player. He was okay.
Yeah.
But not good enough to be footballers. Sometimes they get sons of big. But in the business world, if you've got the right business brain, how often does that breed true?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm still learning about that because I think when I was younger, it was like it's all nature. You've got it or you haven't. And I think a lot of people use that as an excuse for being a victim. I wasn't okay. born like that and I can't do it. Therefore, I'm just not good enough. And you're lucky, Steve, because you were born with the genetics to be the world snooker champion. But then if someone said that to you, you might have gone, well, you don't know how many hours I practice.
Well, yeah. And then that's that thing about, if you put in enough hours, can somebody become good at it? And yeah. I think there's somebody in Australia, I think he's an English guy and his wife, have started to send their 2-year-old and 3-year-old kids to tennis lessons
yeah.
with a view to trying to prove that you can create with enough practice a tennis champion.
Matthew Seid did it. Have you read the book Bounce? Did it in table tennis, same experiment.
Right.
Yeah. It's funny you say this because
I don't believe it.
But
to become very good, I think there's a knack.
Yeah.
But perhaps I'd be proven okay. wrong.
So I wanted to be a pro golfer when I was younger. Never got anywhere near it, really. I got into sort of high single figures when I was 13, 14. Various things got in the way and I didn't make it.
Have you got aspirations for the seniors tour?
Well,
that's a classic, classic mistake.
Yes, yeah. And I really want to raise my boy to be world number one golfer. And he started when he was one. And I haven't got the genes of being a professional golfer or the best in the world.
It's a bit late now, one.
Because I wasn't. Okay, yeah. There you go. Anyway, he played in the world under six as the youngest competitor when he just turned five.
And right.
He came in the second third.
Yeah.
And he won the qualifier as the youngest player to play next year's under six. But next year he'll be in the right age group because he was only just turned five. And so these two, I'm in this parallel universe. It's these two tennis. We should have an interview in like 17 years and see how I did.
I think it's fascinating. Yeah, because obviously if you play enough of something, you are it's what you know. You're learning to ride a bike to the nth degree. You're so proficient at that particular thing. I still think that there's going to be somebody comes along who's more naturally gifted than the hard worker who can just cut through a lot quicker.
But could the naturally gifted person be the person who's just learned better? By the way, I'm not trying to cause an argument. It's a fascinating debate, which...
Well, I'm involved with our coaching scheme. We are involved in getting more coaches on board, but also we go into schools and sometimes do Q zone into schools, which is to some degree good for snooker to expose it to younger children, but also the teachers quite like it because it's another way of learning maths. Mm. But we take loads of small tables into a school, and we're bumping into lots of kids that have never picked a cue up in their life.
Right.
And it's amazing how some people naturally gifted, and others don't even know what end to hold, so to speak.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there's not really any tuition has gone into that. You could just, and all of a sudden you can spot somebody. You can just go, that person's got it. They've got the feel, they've got the touch.
Yeah.
So I'm very much down the road of it's a knack. But
I've got an open mind, that's all I'll say, because I think when I was the victim myself who always assumed who people were good were lucky and had the genes, I wrote myself off at ever being successful. Because I don't have business genes. I was in a lot of debt as an artist before I got into business and property. So... Okay, someone could say, well, they were latent within you when you were born. But there's been no biologist that's cracked DNA and gone, Steve Davis, there's the snooker 6-times world champion gene. But with Stephen, there's the, is he 7 or is he 8?
Yeah, 7.
Yeah, so there's been no chromosome, has there, that's...
Well, it'd be a terrible world if you could find what that is, because then obviously then you're going to be able to orchestrate that as well. You could create somebody. But... I don't know if it applies just to sport or if it applies to business. I would say probably it applies to everything. Mm. You've either got it or you haven't. Would be my
Okay, that's good. Right. By the way, that's question one.
Oh dear. Have we got to?
Yeah, we're all right. How are we doing for time?
Okay.
Yeah, we've still got
that's
one.
Question
all right.
one.
Yeah. I like to just let it roll how it rolls. All right, so maybe we'll do some quick fire ones.
Okay.
Take us to the exact time when you found out, is it MBE before OBE?
MBE.
Yeah.
Yeah, MBE, yeah.
You got both, didn't you, MBE, OBE?
Yeah, well, I think, yeah, well, effectively, when you get OBE, you're no longer MBE.
Right,
so you dropped like a hot stone, you have to...
Right, you have to give it back.
You're supposed to give it back, actually.
Yeah, okay, so MBE, was that in the late 90s?
Late 80s,
okay. Do you remember the exact time when you got the letter or you got the call or whatever and how you felt?
I don't remember exactly. How I felt was ambivalent towards awards.
Yeah.
But proud, not so much for me, but very pleased for Snooker.
Yeah.
Because Snooker's had the sign of a misspent youth.
Yeah.
Doom hanging over it.
Right.
Cloud, and so the fact that Snooker players were getting recognition at government level.
Yeah.
Which where it comes from, I think.
Yeah. Was so good for the sport.
Was good for the sport. Yeah. So I was proud to accept it, and I have no views one way or the other as the awards itself.
Okay. Yeah. Fair enough. If you were to disrupt snooker, so you know, suggesting improvements, trying to get a bigger reach, get the players more earnings, whatever. Give us a couple of things you might do.
I think snooker's popularity is because it works because of the fact that you can see the tension building up.
Yeah.
So plenty of people go put a shot clock in, make it faster,
yeah,
fast food. I think why it works is for the complete opposite. It's a bit right, like putting a shot clock into poker because
yeah,
you want to speed up the thinking process,
yeah,
but you lose the tension.
Right, that's interesting.
So actually, whilst everybody's going, let's put more razzmatazz into it, funnily enough, over the years, why it's worked is because it's actually slow,
yeah,
strangely.
Right.
And people don't realise where they're getting their value.
Yeah.
So it's a good book as opposed to the short story.
Yeah.
So in a world of fast food things happening, where everybody's trying to make everybody like low attention span, and everybody's going, oh, we've got to make this, we've got to make it 2020 cricket, we'll make it 10-10 cricket, 5-5 cricket, whatever it's going to be, you know?
Yeah.
Actually, don't. If effectively, I would say go against the flow. Because why it's worked and why it's been so popular is for exactly the same reasons. So making it faster is not going to work.
Yeah.
So and trying to make it anything more than it is, you're trying too hard.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't change a thing.
Right. Okay. Good answer. Your answer. If you could unpick why you think, let's start with Stephen Hendry. Why do you think he was so successful? You could unpick a couple of traits.
Fantastic bully, very self-centered, in a nice way.
Yeah.
Very driven by winning.
Yeah.
And had great temperament. That is something that, whilst you do learn it, is something that is handy if you've got it in abundance. Yeah. And I think one of the reasons why he retired so quickly was that once he stopped winning, he lost interest.
Him.
It
yeah,
hurt him a lot. Mm. I was able to some degree, go down a pan a lot further, a bit more masochistic, perhaps. He wasn't having any of it.
No.
He decided to retire in the top 16 because he wasn't winning.
Yeah.
Astonishing in sport to retire within the top of the game.
Right.
He
yeah,
did it. And I think that was one of his strengths. Turned out to be one of perhaps the weaknesses. He couldn't handle losing
yeah,
as much. And so he never got any... He didn't win again
yeah,
after he started losing.
Yeah.
I had a couple of wins after I started losing.
Yeah.
But Stephen, it seemed like all of a sudden that was the end, and he sort of,
right,
not saying he threw his teddies out the pram, but
yeah,
he decided that he wasn't going to,
yeah,
he wasn't enjoying it.
Sure. Okay, Ronnie, what couple of things that made Ronnie really successful?
Well, Ronnie really successful for the exact reason that I claim that it's natural and you can't teach it.
Yeah.
He was born to have a cue in his hand.
He looks like he was.
He's like a pimple wizard.
Yeah.
He's like Tommy on. He's like he's one with the machine.
Yeah.
With a cue in his hand at the table, you'll never see anybody more comfortable.
Yeah.
And that is something, you know, you can't teach somebody how to hit the ball. You can show them the mechanics, but to feel the balls
yeah,
as he feels them, he's on another level. He's the only person I'd love to see through his eyes what he's seeing when he comes to the table.
Yeah.
There's nobody else, even Stephen Hendry, that I think that would think on a different level to me.
Yeah.
Even though Stephen Hendry's a marvellous break builder.
Yeah.
But Ronnie O'Sullivan, I think he probably sees different pictures. He's
yeah,
seen it in 4D.
Yeah, and it seems like he sees it really quick.
ridiculously so quickly.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, he's been playing since he was 10.
Yeah.
There is that.
When did you start? How old were you?
14 when I started.
Right.
It wasn't a done thing to be playing at 10.
No, sure. Because it's interesting with Nick Fowler, he started quite late in golf.
Yeah,
I think in his teens, which is quite late for golf.
I mean, think if you the danger is you try to make somebody play too early.
Yeah,
they rebel against it. Yeah. So be careful with your kids.
Well, I do heed and take those warnings because it is definitely a balancing act. Because just quickly, on the one hand, I think you should encourage your children to do things that challenge them. Because if you just always say, oh, don't worry, okay, do what you want. Some of them a bit hand, do what you want. You just end up creating a little bit of maybe a diva or juvenile.
Yeah, yeah.
So you've got to put them through some challenges, I think.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't want to build a dislike in the game through forcing him. So.
No. Yeah. But once they play competitively, you'll find out whether they like it or not.
Yeah.
That's when all of a sudden that's the acid test. So when they start to enter tournaments because they want to enter them.
Right, yeah.
And then when they get the disappointments, you'll see then if you've got a champion or just somebody who wasn't really what they wanted to do.
Okay. What if you could go back and give yourself advice just as you turned pro around about that era, what advice would you give yourself?
The advice I'd give myself is exactly what we talked about earlier, which was spend a little less time on pure technique and a lot more time on studying the positional side of my game.
Yeah.
No other parts.
Okay. And then would you go, just as you finished your snooker career and went into your new phase of life, is that if you could go back that then, were you late 30s, 40s at that sort of time?
40s perhaps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What advice would you give yourself if you could go back then?
I don't think I'd do anything differently. I think I've sort of gone with the flow, but I don't necessarily think I was the right type of animal to go into business.
Yeah.
I don't think anything could ever be as exciting as playing in the World Snooker Championship and all of those events. So anything I touched after that would have been less of an exciting life.
Yeah.
And I may not have been good enough to be successful at it. So I sort of stayed as effectively within the game that I knew and did other things within it.
Okay. This podcast is called The Disruptive Entrepreneur. What does the word disruptive mean to you?
I think within my own sport, the word disruptive would sum up one of the greatest snooker players that ever held a cue, a guy called Alex Hurricane Higgins, who loved to disrupt the authority of the game and on various occasions pushed them to the limits. And whilst sometimes they claimed it was because of an alcoholic problem, he was quite a rebel and people loved him for it. You know, he tested everybody, bow ties thrown away, licking the cue ball, nutting an official and punching another one, regularly swearing and where he was, the game was trying to keep him under control, but he wasn't having anything. You know, wearing coloured shirts when we wanted white ones.
Yeah.
Wonderful. But from the point of view of the word disruption, also I quite like it because I think only by trial and error sometimes do you ever learn anything. So I quite like the idea that if you do things in a different way, things can happen.
Yeah. You do quite a lot of keynote speaking now, is that right? After dinner, sort of keynote speaking, you're going to do one for us?
Yes, I am. The word keynote is a wonderful word. I haven't got a clue what it means.
No, I don't either.
It sounds wonderful. Yeah. But it's a wonderful thing to think that you can do keynote speaking. Obviously, a lot of the people in the sporting world do motivational speaking.
Yeah.
Which is also, that the word motivation is a big, big word.
Yeah.
I prefer to do demotivational speaking. And I think that works just as well.
Yeah. Okay. Is there a question I should have asked you that I haven't?
No. No, because whilst I like talking about myself, really, I think I've talked enough about myself in my life that there is no other question.
Yeah.
There's no questions left.
Okay.
Well, I mean, other than what is the purpose of being on the planet, which I don't know the answer to,
okay,
and what is dark matter, I think we've covered it.
All right, then. Growth and contribution.
Yes, very good.
How about those?
Yeah, lovely.
All right, then.
Yeah.
Great.
Steve, I love
Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure.
Thanks a lot.